staffing and on the number of ventilators? And what are our plans for that really pointy end of COVID treatment?
There's concern too that current vaccination targets, cited for some easing of restrictions, are likely too low for the health system to be able to cope with the increase in cases that could bring. Omar Khorshid believes additional modelling needs to be done to determine what rate can be sustained.
They need to say, is our system going to survive at 70%? Will it survive at 80%? Or do we need to go higher? And we'd really like to make sure that the modelling that's done does take into account a realistic look at what our public hospitals can cope with.
All right, let's go to the US now. And a new abortion law has come into effect in the state of Texas, which bans terminations after 6 weeks, even if a pregnancy is the result of rape or incest. President Joe Biden says the law blatantly violates Roe v. Wade, the Supreme Court ruling which legalized abortion nationwide nearly 50 years ago. He says his administration is deeply committed to protecting and defending constitutional abortion rights. The BBC's Barbara Pletusha reports from Washington.
This law makes Texas the hardest state in which to get an abortion. It bans the procedure before most women even know they're pregnant. Abortion providers and rights activists say that will rule out nearly all abortions in Texas and force clinics to close. They also say it's unconstitutional because the Roe v. Wade ruling allows abortions up to the 24th week of pregnancy. For this reason, courts have blocked similar bans in a dozen other states. The Supreme Court could still put a hold on the Texas law, but failed to act on an emergency appeal to stop it from going into effect. The law is also unusual because it allows private citizens to sue abortion providers and anyone involved in facilitating abortions, even someone who drives a woman to a clinic. And they'd get $10,000 if they won the case, so critics are calling it a bounty hunting scheme. This is one of many recent efforts to limit abortions in states controlled by Republicans, who've been emboldened by the conservative majority on the Supreme Court. Activists fear that if it's allowed to stand, it will provide momentum for similar laws and strengthen the challenge to national abortion rights.
All schools have been ordered to close in Nigeria's northwest following the latest mass abduction of students. A teacher said 76 students and a member of staff had been taken. More details from the BBC's Ishak Khalid.
Witnesses say they saw when the kidnappers were seizing the children and moving away with them from Government Day Secondary School Kaya Maradu in Zamfara State. One of the school teachers told the BBC there were around 400 students in the school. Many of the children fled during the Wednesday morning attack. Kidnappings for ransom have become common in Nigeria, and the deployment of thousands of troops by the government has so far failed to tackle the crisis. Since December, more than 1,000 students have been abducted across Nigeria, most of them freed after ransom payments to the kidnappers.
A Russian official has warned the International Space Station could suffer irreparable failures because of outdated equipment and hardware. At least 80% of systems on the Russian part of the station have passed their expiry date. So small cracks have also been discovered which could worsen over time. Such issues have been feared for some time and could lead to the International Space Station being incapable of operating beyond 2030. The skeleton of a 66-million-year-old giant triceratops fossil could soon belong to a lucky dinosaur enthusiast. That is, if they have an estimated $2 million to spare. The specimen going to auction, dubbed Big John, has a skull more than 2.5 meters long and 2 meters wide, while his two longest horns are a meter long and more than 30 centimeters wide at their base. It's just ticked a minute too. Britney Spears' lawyers have accused her father, Jamie, of dragging his feet over stepping down from his daughter's conservatorship at her request. Mr. Spears, who is 69, has agreed to relinquish control of the US pop star's finances. This week, her lawyer demanded he step down as soon as possible, accusing him of trying to extort money from his daughter. That's World Watch for today. Nice little musical interlude, Marnie.
Thanks, Max. I thoroughly enjoyed that. And that is Midday Report for today. Please stay tuned. We're about to cross live to the Prime Minister and Director General of Health. Have a beautiful day. Hei kona.
RNZ News at 1. Kia ora, I'm Marama Tipole. A decision is expected shortly on whether the Northland region will move to alert level 3 at midnight tonight. The Prime Minister is holding a media conference in the next few minutes. We'll cross to the Beehive when she begins. Earlier this week, Jacinda Ardern said Te Tai Tokoro would move out of Alert Level 4 pending wastewater and swabbing results due today. New figures show the numbers of doctors and nurses waiting to apply for residence has ballooned to almost 3,000. Figures released under the Official Information Act show 2,200 nurses and 675 doctors are waiting for the skilled migrant residence channel to reopen. A consultant radiologist in Hawke's Bay, Philip Clark, says retaining staff is critical with so many shortages, but uncertainty about residency is hanging over them. He says hospitals are having to outsource scan reports at considerable expense, and that will only get worse. Two New Zealand Defence Force personnel deployed to aid evacuations in Kabul have tested positive for COVID-19. A Defence Force spokesperson says they became infected despite being fully vaccinated and following all prevention protocols. They're said to be well and isolating under local-based protocols in the United Arab Emirates. A website for Māori-specific information about COVID-19 has been launched by Te Puni Kōkiri. Māori Development Minister Willie Jackson has called it a new approach to the government's communications response to the pandemic. He says the portal will be a one-stop shop for information on Te Ao Māori, including Māori-led vaccine centres and whānau order. Yesterday, Mr. Jackson conceded to a select committee there had been flaws in the vaccination rollout for Māori. Fonterra exported record volumes in the year to June. The dairy company shipped 2.59 million metric tonnes, equivalent to more than 200,000 containers over a 12-month period. It says it achieved that even as shipping schedule reliability plunged, taking available shipping capacity down 20%. Overseas New Zealanders desperate to return home hope a new online queuing system for booking a managed isolation place will level the playing field. Applications for bookings have been paused for now. When the extended pause lifts, those waiting in the virtual lobby for a MIQ room will be randomly selected. Tim Malone from the group Kiwis Coming Home says the number of people who miss out will be counted for the first time. He says it should be fairer than the current system in which computer bots fight for places. The Salvation Army wants to know where funding for school healthy lunch programs is going during lockdown as pressure mounts on social agencies. Its spokesperson, Ronji Tanielu, says people who were already struggling with both food costs and housing security have been hit hard, especially in Auckland. He says some people with children have become dependent on free lunches in schools in order to get by. The Salvation Army also wants the government to impose a freeze on rent increases to ease the burden of lockdown. An intensive care specialist says it's better to have hospital staff moved to Auckland to treat COVID patients rather than sending patients to other parts of the country. Intensive care workers are under pressure from the rising number of COVID patients, and expressions of interest have gone out to see if staff from other DHBs could help out. Andrew Stapleton of the College of Intensive Care Medicine says it's prudent to plan ahead in case hospital numbers rise. He says Auckland already has an acute shortage of workers because many will have been at locations of interest and need to self-isolate. The head of the Earthquake Commission is stepping down. Sid Miller came to the helm in 2017 when the organisation was under fire for its incompetent handling of earthquake claims in Christchurch. A public inquiry last year found it was totally unprepared to do the job and had made life more difficult for the people it was supposed to be helping. Mr Miller says much of his work has been about leading, dealing with historical issues, rebuilding relationships and learning lessons. And that's the news.
This morning on First Up, we checked up on rest home residents as the time they're isolated drags on.
I've got every kind of entertainment, TV, Netflix, audio books, of course, ordinary books to read, family phones for me and all that. That's how I do it.
And Deputy Prime Minister Grant Robertson swats away accusations that we're running out of vaccine.
We've got continual deliveries. We will still be vaccinating people. And some of the nonsense I've heard people talk about us running out, that is simply not true.
I'm Nathan Rarity. Join me for First Up Lockdown Edition tomorrow from 5am on RNZ National.
Kei te whakarongo mai koe ki te reo irirangi o Aotearoa. Jesse Mulligan is up next. Right now, the short forecast from Met Service to midnight Friday. Northland, Auckland, Coromandel and Gisborne, cloudy periods and isolated showers. Waikato, Taupo and Bay of Plenty fine, apart from isolated afternoon and evening showers tomorrow. And we interrupt our weather across to the media conference.
Kia ora koutou katoa. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to outline the details of Northland's move to alert level 3 tonight, take a look at how that level is going across the rest of the country south of Auckland. And Minister Henare is here to make an announcement about increased support for whānau ora. But first, I'll hand over to Dr. Bloomfield to give us the latest on case numbers.
Thank you, Prime Minister. Kia ora koutou katoa. So today there are 49 new cases to report in the community. All of these are in Auckland. This takes our total number of cases in this outbreak to 725, with 709 of these in Auckland and 16 in Wellington. There are a further 4 cases to report in recent returnees in our managed isolation facilities. So this latest lower number is encouraging and does show our alert level 4 measures are working, even against the Delta strain. As I mentioned yesterday, the numbers could still bounce around a little. However, the latest reassessment of the effective reproduction rate shows that based on data through to the 31st of August, there was a 95% probability this was under 1. Analysis of yesterday's cases shows that 85% were contacts of known cases, and 56% were household contacts who were already isolating. 36% of yesterday's cases, the ones announced yesterday, were considered to be infectious in the community. That is higher than the 25% the previous day. I think the Prime Minister has some updated last-minute information on the cases we're reporting today. There are 42 cases now in hospital, all in the Auckland area. Of these, 6 are in ICU or a high dependency unit, and 3 are being ventilated. The growing number of people in hospital is a stark reminder of the seriousness of infection with the COVID-19 virus. My thoughts are with those who are in hospital and indeed their whānau at what must be a stressful time for them. As of 9 a.m. today, we had 37,359 individual contacts formally identified and in our national contact tracing system. Of these, 30,283, or 81%, had direct contact by our team and were self-isolating. Most of the balance had already been identified by in our system because they had had contact with Healthline or through being at a place of interest. Around 86% of all contacts have already had a test in the system. And obviously work is ongoing to follow up all remaining contacts. Of the 336 contacts known to be located in Northland, all have been contacted by our contact tracers. 96% so far have returned a test, all negative, and any contacts with an outstanding test result are being followed up today by the local public health unit. Yesterday there were 17,683 tests processed nationwide. There were just 6,700 swabs taken across the Metro Auckland region yesterday, 3,000 at community testing centres and 3,700 at general practice and urgent care clinics. We need to have higher levels of testing across Tamaki Makaurau to give us confidence that we have the outbreak under control. If you have symptoms, any symptoms at all, or have been at a location of interest or are a contact and should be tested, please do so. This is absolutely essential for our understanding of whether the outbreak is under control and therefore having Auckland in alert level 4 for the shortest time possible. ESR continues to conduct whole genome sequencing at pace with 469 genomes sequenced to date. This analysis serves many functions, including investigation of the current source outbreaks and understanding, of course, of the variant that has made its way into New Zealand. We have confidence from all of those tests that we have only had only a single incursion into the community. As the virus spreads, it accumulates small changes in its genome, and we're using these signals to provide pointers on possible transmission pathways in the community and to link cases. For example, a recent case of a MIF worker could be definitively linked via genomics to a specific subcluster in the community, and this infection was not acquired from other cases in the managed isolation facility where that person worked. So we have so far successfully sequenced approximately 75% of the notified outbreak cases to date. On wastewater testing, there are no unexpected results to report today. Importantly, samples collected from Northland from locations across that region on Monday and Tuesday have all returned negative results. And this included wastewater from local communities between 100 to almost 50,000 in population. So far, wastewater testing has been undertaken in 148 places across the country, covering an estimated 3.8 million people, and that's 95% of people covered by our reticulated wastewater systems. Just turning to briefly to a couple of testing results. As you're aware, there was a positive test result received from a worker at the Spring Hill Corrections Facility a couple of days ago. Negative results have been received from subsequent swabs taken from this worker, and so our investigations continue. At this stage, it remains a positive result under investigation as opposed to a positive case. However, all precautions remain in place as if this is an acute infection. All tests to date from co-workers and inmates have returned negative. There was also a case I referred to yesterday as being under investigation. It was identified at mid-central DHB region and has since been determined to be an historical case previously reported overseas and not linked at all to our numbers, to our outbreak here. A message to our essential workers in the Auckland region: it is vital that if you have any symptoms at all, or you have been at a location of interest, that you do not go to work. Let your employer know, stay home, ring Healthline for advice on where to get a test, and isolate in your bubble until you have the results of that test. For essential workers who are crossing back and forth between the Auckland and Alert Level 3 boundary, I am asking you to get tested within the next 3 to 4 days, even if you have no symptoms. We are looking at how to put in place a system to check that these commuting essential workers are being regularly tested to support our efforts now and in the future. We will also be putting in place a system for regular surveillance testing at the moment of certain groups of asymptomatic essential workers, and I'll have more to say about that in coming days. There's been a great response from DHBs across the country to help out their counterparts in the Auckland region, and we have now 112 staff who have made themselves available to work across Auckland in a range of areas, including in intensive care, contact tracing, infection prevention and control, and our quarantine facilities. We're working closely as a Ministry of Health to support the Auckland DHBs with their needs. On boundary exemptions, as you know, there is a regional boundary, of course, separating Auckland and Northland from the rest of New Zealand. So whilst the regional border is closed for personal travel, there are exemptions available for exceptional circumstances, and these are processed by the Ministry. As at 8 a.m. this morning, we'd received 384 applications for exemptions for personal travel in both directions. Of those that were eligible, noting that some applications were for activities that are already permitted under the relevant order, about 95% have been declined. This is because even at Alert Level 3, people should generally be staying at home unless it is absolutely essential to do otherwise, and a tight boundary around our Alert Level 4 area is essential to stop the virus spreading. I acknowledge and understand that many applications we've received are potentially difficult situations for people. However, very few of them give rise to absolutely urgent, necessary or essential travel. In terms of our vaccine rollout, yesterday 89,546 doses were administered at 578 vaccination sites. And with the opening up of booking for anyone 12 and above, there were nearly 200,000 new bookings made yesterday. And so 70% of all New Zealanders aged 12 and over now either have a booking in our system or have been vaccinated with at least one dose. Finally, more than 24,000 essential workers have had their first vaccination over the last couple of weeks. More primary care sites are coming on stream each day to help administer the vaccine to all our population across the Motu. Thank you, Prime Minister.
Thank you, Dr. Bloomfield. As you will have heard from Dr. Bloomfield, our case numbers are moving around a little bit at this stage. That's not unusual. They did this the last time we were moving through what we would anticipate would be a level 4 peak. The important thing is we are starting to see some positive trends in the numbers. I thought I'd share a few of those today. First, our rolling day average of cases is declining. It's overall across that rolling average 61 today. 5 days ago, it was more like 77, and it has been heading down over time. Secondly, we are seeing fewer cases that are infectious in the community. Today, around 14% or 7 of the cases that are being reported were considered to be infectious in the community, a number that has been falling since lockdown. But just to be clear though, that doesn't imply that those individuals were necessarily breaking any of the rules. For instance, the most common exposure event for these 7 people was visiting a supermarket or a dairy. And for those 7 people, the number of exposure events in total were 9. Overall, the number of cases without exposure events and already in isolation as contacts of existing cases has also been increasing. This means our contact tracing is making a difference. It's identifying contacts and getting them isolated and stopping the spread of the virus to others. And while we expect to continue to see cases of in-household transmission, lockdown and isolation is really supporting us as we try and stop the spread beyond that. So not only has lockdown stopped that exponential spread of Delta, there's clear evidence that our plan is making a difference to extinguish those last chains of transmission so that we can reduce restrictions as soon as possible. We do, however, just need to make sure we're sticking to the plan and sticking to it firmly. This is where I want to add a message. If you are a contact, if you've been at a location of interest and advised to stay home as a result, you absolutely must do so. If you don't, you're risking the health of those around you and you risk prolonging this lockdown for yourself and for others. Now, while we haven't seen widespread evidence of this being an issue, it is such an important message. I will keep repeating it nonetheless. A quick update on Northland. You'll recall that we kept Northland at level 4 for an extra 48 hours because of the late emergence of cases in the Warkworth area and a large worksite involved, and the need to get some extra reassurance that we hadn't seen undetected transmission in the wider community as a result of some of those later discoveries of cases. 27 extra wastewater samples were taken from 26 sites right across the region on Monday and Tuesday. None have detected COVID-19. On that basis, we can confirm that Northland will move to alert level 3 at 11:50pm tonight as planned. I want to thank everyone in Northland for their patience while we built just that extra bit of peace of mind that everything is contained and confined within the boundaries we expect. Northland will now be treated in line with the rest of New Zealand outside of Auckland, with settings reviewed on Monday, the 6th of September. The shift to Alert Level 3 in the north brings in the northern Alert Level boundary, in addition to the boundaries that's already operating in the south of Auckland. Police continue to engage with iwi regarding the management of the northern checkpoints, but rest assured the purpose of the checkpoints is to keep COVID out. The northern checkpoints will be set up again at the following locations: State Highway 1 and Mangawhai Road, Mangawhai Road and north of Coal Hill Road, Black Swamp west of Rako Road, Mangawhai Road and Keynes Road, and Mangawhai Road and Ryan Road. Remember that personal travel between alert levels is highly limited and requires permission or an exemption. The same applies to business and work travel across the boundary, which is also strictly limited. These tight restrictions appear to be working well. I'm told by police that traffic movement on the southern boundary has been low and orderly. A huge thanks to all those who applied for their essential business travel documents in advance. It really has made a difference. I'm advised that overall, compliance on day one of level 3 has been good. A couple of reminders though. Level 3 this time is different for Delta, and specifically there are new requirements for mask wearing. Anyone working at a business that is open and outwardly facing at level 3 must wear a mask, and anyone visiting that business, such as someone making a contactless pickup, must also wear a mask. But just as a general rule, if you're leaving the house, please wear a mask. It makes all the difference. I've also been advised that there, unfortunately, have been multiple reports of abuse towards bus drivers and other essential transport staff over the past couple of weeks. There is never any justification for lashing out at our essential workers. They are effectively putting themselves at risk every day to keep crucial services running. Every one of them is doing their best under very challenging circumstances. Please, I would ask everyone, be patient and be kind. I know that we would all be very saddened and appalled to hear that some of our essential workers have been having this experience. Finally, I want to speak to some of the recent decisions made by Cabinet to support those community organisations and providers who have surged their support in this outbreak. You'll recall we have done this for our food security network with an additional $7 million in funding to support the COVID response. And today I can announce that Cabinet has approved over $49 million in additional funding to support whānau ora and Pacific providers to assist in responding to the current outbreak, especially given it is disproportionately impacting the Pacific community. This funding will also assist in the highest possible uptake of the vaccine across Māori and Pacific communities. The extra Pacific funding allocation of $26 million will go towards health and disability services, sustaining the response to the current outbreak, including welfare support, scaling up mobile outreach and Pacific community vaccination services, and supporting ongoing engagement and communications to specific ethnic groups within the Pacific community. Last lockdown, whānau ora also rallied, adapted and evolved to meet the changing needs of Māori communities. They were a linchpin, providing not only practical support, but a huge amount of comfort for communities. This time around, the demand on their service has been even greater. The changed definition and widening of our use of contacts linked to active cases means the number of people who have had to isolate has increased. I want to hand over now to Minister Henare to set out the details of the additional whānau ora funding, and then we'll be happy to open for questions.
Tēnā koutou, greetings one and all. Thank you, Prime Minister. Whānau ora has once again, as the Prime Minister has mentioned, swiftly mobilised networks and pivoted resources to provide the critical support whānau need during this lockdown. I am pleased today to announce that we have committed an additional $23 million to whānau ora so that it can continue to provide this necessary support. Of the additional $23 million, the three whānau ora commissioning agencies will receive an immediate boost of $8.8 million so they can continue to provide direct and integrated support to whānau. A further $14.2 million will be allocated based on need as information on the impact of the current change in alert levels unfolds. This funding will help whānau ora to meet the increased demand for their services and ultimately will help whānau endure these challenging times. Whānau ora is already helping whānau with essential goods such as kai, utilities and connectivity. Whānau ora providers have re-established testing sites, 0800 support lines and food banks across the motu. Whānau ora navigators are working tirelessly to support the holistic needs of whānau, supporting them with their material well-being, health, housing and education needs, together to ensure they get the support that they need. Lastly, I would like to extend a huge thank you to the commissioning agencies, the whānau ora partner network, our navigators, and lastly, whānau, for trusting in whānau ora. Kia ora tātou.
Thank you, Minister Henare. What I might do is, if we have questions for on the whānau ora announcement, can I bring those forward and undertake those at the beginning of our question and answer, and that way we won't have too much jostling at the front. So, Ukawai.
Does it take Māori and Pacifica to be in crisis mode before we're going to see these kinds of fundings drop to whānau ora? We know that the vulnerabilities of Māori and Pacifica communities have been well canvassed long before this outbreak, but does it take an outbreak to see funding get to communities?
No, absolutely not. We had increased whānau order funding before we had the tragedy of COVID-19 as a pandemic affecting our Māori and Pacific communities. So absolutely not. But what we also recognise is the additional impact that this pandemic is having on those communities. And I would say the same for the vaccine rollout. We already had additional support for the vaccine rollout for Māori and Pacific communities. This is on top of that once again. But I'll let Minister Henare speak to some of those numbers.
Thank you, Prime Minister. The numbers of the most recent whānau ora budget of 2020 was quite clear that there were two parts to that. That was for the response and the resilience for whānau. So we want to continue that, and which is why this particular announcement today is for the immediate response that whānau ora have been able to swing and pivot into action right away. I would also like to add that with respect to that response, we made it clear when we negotiate with our commissioning agencies that the money that was given and offered for the resilience and building resilience of whānau would continue to be an agile and nimble process as we look towards responding towards lockdowns like we've seen in the past couple of weeks. So, no, I'm proud of the work we've done for whānau ora, and we'll continue to support a kaupapa that works.
What does that funding breakdown look like? Well, how is that going to be broken down?
So, of the $23 million announced today, I've already mentioned $8.8 million will be distributed under the normal whānau ora formula. That means it's spread across the three commissioning agencies. I also said that a further $14.2 million would be held back while we assess the need of ongoing support required through this particular lockdown. The Prime Minister and Dr. Bloomfield have already stated that Tāmaki Makaurau is at the heart of this current lockdown, so we want to make sure that those resources are aimed and targeted at supporting where it's needed the most.
Yeah, Prime Minister, for you on this topic. Minister Henare has spoken this week about targeted incentives for young Māori people, rangatahi, in order to get them vaccinated. You've already seen the likes of Ngāti Hinau Trust, for example, in Moriwa are doing that. It's also some kura kaupapas might be doing it in Northland too. Is there going to be a national approach in terms of rolling that out, and will it be targeted specifically to Māori, or will it be across the board with young people?
I think the most important thing is that actually we give the ability of our local providers to do what is going to work for their communities. They know their communities best, and we want to see innovation in our vaccine rollout and people not feeling constrained that they can, if they believe, identify initiatives that will make a difference, that they can do that. And I've shared from this podium a number of times before some of the things that I've seen in terms of mobile vaccine clinics that vary across the country, dependent on who it is they're targeting and who they're working for. For instance, before the outbreak, I was talking to one of our North Island providers. They were looking at providing events where they had food trucks coming in to try and create events around vaccination, to try and bring in different cohorts, different age groups. So we want that flexibility and that innovation. On incentives, we have had some work being done by the vaccination team on other countries have used incentives, and they've been used in different ways. So we've got enough research out there to demonstrate when they work and when they don't work. So that's information we can make sure we provide providers so they can see what's been used overseas.
So it sounds as if you're saying that basically if Māori health providers think it is a strategy that works, like Ngāti Hinau, that they're able to, does that mean that you are going to give them additional funding to cover the costs of the fact that they think that that works?
So I'm not going to speak to individual initiatives here. What I am saying is that we want innovation. We want providers to be able to undertake initiatives that they think will make a difference for their communities. I don't want to get into the specifics of different incentive regimes, whether they work or not work, or equity issues that come about if you employ them for certain communities that haven't been available other places. But as a general rule, we want providers to do what works.
So you can't give an assurance whether they'll actually be funded to do that, because Minister Henare, you obviously are supportive of it from your comments this week. So are you going to give some assurance to these Māori health providers they'll actually get the funding to do it?
Joe, all I'm saying is that I don't know the specifics around the ask for some of those providers, how they intend to do it, whether or not they're doing that off their own bat, whether they're seeking extra support. So I just don't want to get too far in advance of the question. I'm happy to pass over briefly to Minister Henare. I might then see if there's any more for him, and then we'll move on to general.
Thank you, Prime Minister. At the beginning of the year, $40 million was the budget put forward to promote and execute a vaccine rollout for Māori people. My understanding from officials is that there is still some resource there to look how we might support more specific and bespoke incentives to bring young people and to bring the Māori population forward. But ultimately, the number one message to the Māori population is come forward and make yourself available for the vaccine.
Just focusing on the Pacific funding for the providers. For dating back to last year, we've had Pacific community leaders and clinicians saying that the community engagement hasn't been up to par with what they've been saying. Hasn't been up to par up until this point. Is this funding by the government the way of you guys conceding that there's been a failure for Pacific communities during this COVID response?
Well, you will have heard me say before from this podium that the only people who can deem whether or not our communication has been what it needs to be is the community itself. And if they tell us that we need to have done better, then we need to have done better. And so in the last outbreak, we equally put in support for those providers that we were really calling on for surge capacity, helping with welfare needs, extra testing. So those communities that we've called on are then the providers that we're then supporting with additional funding. So that's what happened last time, that's what we're doing again. Because, of course, it's only, unfortunately, when that provision is, when we're needing to do those welfare checks, those extra, for instance, meeting those extra needs while people are in isolation, when you see that we need to then come in straight away with the funding to support the providers to do that job. In other outbreaks, that hasn't always been the case. You didn't see that, for instance, in other parts of the country more recently when we've had outbreaks. So where the need is where we go.
Just to follow on from Joe's question.
Yep.
Allowing for that space for innovation in the Māori vaccine rollout, is that just purely because the government doesn't know what they're doing when it comes
no.
to the Māori vaccine rollout?
You can't have it both ways. So, of course, we have a duty to make sure that we are making the vaccination program available, that we are working alongside providers in community and we are funding them to support them to roll out in community. But at the same time, of course, we have to allow innovation as well. If we were too regimented on the provision, then you wouldn't see some of the initiatives that have managed to reach into communities because those providers know their community best. Dr. Bloomfield, you might have something you want to say on that.
Just to say that, as Minister Henare said, there was funding made available right at the start of the program, recognising that both Māori and Pacific providers would have additional costs to stand up the vaccination programs they're delivering, and to work with them to ensure that they had both flexibility but also access to other support and resources that we can provide from the centre, including comms resources and so on. So that's been in place right from the start of the program. Clearly over the last 2 weeks we've seen that big increase in vaccination rates, including amongst Māori and Pacifica. So we are looking at what additional resources they need and regular conversations underway.
Yeah.
Dr. Bloomfield,
okay.
This is kind of a triple barrel, but if you could maybe give us a bit of an update about how many negative pressure rooms we have and how many more are being added. Also, how many more ICU nurses are needed to join Auckland's response. And then just following on from that, were hospitals prepared enough for this outbreak? Should those things have been ready to go if we knew that Delta was likely to reach New Zealand?
Thank you. And I'm going to start with just a correction of the numbers, which is not a question you asked, but the number I gave of 736 total cases, sorry, I gave 725. That's the number of active cases. The total for this outbreak should be 736, with 720 in Auckland and 16 in Wellington.
So we have 11 recovered.
We have 11 recovered. So to your question about negative pressure ventilation rooms, so all our DHBs have NPV rooms, and Auckland, three Auckland DHBs have got a number between them, a large number, including on wards and in intensive care units. We use negative pressure ventilation rooms where we have a few cases, and the key thing there is if you have other people on either wards or an ICU who are not COVID positive, you want to make sure that you're not putting them at risk. When you move to a situation where you've got more patients than NPV rooms, then you move, the next step is move to a dedicated ward or area for those COVID patients. And so that is the planning that is now ongoing, not the planning, that is what has now been implemented, because as I said, the number of hospitalisations has now hit over 40. The ICU nurses are among some of the nursing staff who've been brought in to the Auckland region. When you have COVID-positive patients in the intensive care unit, you separate out your nursing and other staff to make sure that those looking after the COVID patients are just dedicated there. And so this is bringing extra staff in so that those DHBs can keep the separate streams of staff working in intensive care units. And in terms of preparation, yes, there certainly was very good preparation in place. But what is happening now, of course, is you're seeing the plans being put into action in terms of getting additional staff from outside of the region as and when needed, standing up extra quarantine facilities given the large number of cases and so on.
And Prime Minister, could there be an earlier alert level shift for the South Island considering they're still COVID-free? And separately, what changes have been made to NCEA and why?
So, no, that hasn't been part of our plan. We've said that we want to bring all of the review for all of New Zealand through to Monday. And one of the reasons for that is, of course, while we have several hundred contacts that have been in the South Island, those are the ones we know. And whilst those have been contact traced, they've been tested, they are the ones that are known to us and our ministry team. There may well be others connected to these cases that we don't know about. So level three provides that extra layer of caution. Our goal is to keep COVID out of the South Island. Stepping down cautiously is the best way that we can assure that when we do lift restrictions, it stays that way and those businesses can remain free of some of the challenges we're facing elsewhere.
On NCEA.
So look, I think we will possibly be ensuring that Minister Hipkins may be available to answer some of the detailed questions around that. But what we've really forward planning for is if we have schools in Kura who are disrupted by alert level 3 or 4 for a total of 4 weeks or more, some additional changes around NCEA, and they particularly relate to learning recognition credits and thresholds to receive course and certificate endorsements. It's really just us trying to mitigate some of the impacts of level 3 and 4 on our students for prolonged periods.
On the South Island.
Going back to the health workers issue, health workers have told us that Novotel is not currently staffed to look after COVID patients, which is why many of them are being offloaded to hospitals. What's your response to that, and how well resourced are Jet Park and Novotel with the necessary healthcare staff to adequately care for COVID patients?
Yes, certainly one of the key inputs into standing up a new quarantine facility like the Novotel and indeed the Holiday Inn, which is coming on board today, is ensuring we've got enough health staff. And in fact, the stand-up of the Holiday Inn was deferred by 24 hours to ensure that there were sufficient health staff there. So I'm confident that not only have they got the health staff they need to run the those new quarantine facilities, but that also they are able to provide the level of care that might be needed for people who are in those facilities. And, you know, with large numbers, hundreds of people with COVID-19, many of those people are quite unwell. Most of them can be cared for as if they were at home, but they're in these facilities, but some will need hospital-level care. And that's when they require hospital-level care, that's when they're taken to hospital.
And Prime Minister, just in terms of people who are in isolation, is 4 o'clock too late for children in isolation to wait for lunch?
Well, so if I firstly on the MIQ, if I could just add that the alternative to our contacts being in MIQ would be them being at home, which is what a large number of countries would otherwise do. By having them in our managed isolation facilities, it means that, yes, we have that care on hand and available, and able, I would say, to much more quickly make an assessment if someone needs hospital-level care than if they're spread out around their homes around Auckland. On your question, that is not usual practice within our isolation and quarantine facilities. Certainly from what I know of them, they are very regular and routine in their provision of service to those who are in our facilities. And 160,000 New Zealanders who have been through our facilities would be able to attest to that. So if that's happened, that strikes me as being an unusual set of circumstances, and I would be happy to look into whether or not what issues have caused that.
It has happened, and there's...
I pick that up from your question.
Yeah, there's distressing video of a woman in the MIQ with her children waiting for them to be fed, and then she's broken the bubble and gone down to see staff members,
Is that disappointing? And what sort of is being done in terms of the mental health impact for people in isolation with children and ensuring that they get what they need, including exercise?
And of course, there are different restrictions around people who are COVID positive, around their ability to move around facilities. But our teams in our managed isolation facilities do an incredible job of particularly trying to care for families where they have children, learning packs, providing as much stimulation as they can for those kids because they know how difficult it is. But as I say, 160,000 New Zealanders have been through our facilities and by and large have an incredible experience despite the tough circumstances. I would need to look into that individual case to understand what happened there specifically because that is not usually the experience of most people. What is critical is that people comply. It's critical. It's critical to the health and safety of the staff and to the families. And what you're explaining to me sounds highly unusual given the 160,000 people we've had through, and I know the huge act of service that our MIQ workers give to working in those facilities every single day. Just try and paint around those who haven't. Jane.
Can you please outline what kind of effect bringing staff in from other parts of the country might have on elective and outpatient? Also the age of people in ICU and their status. And for the Prime Minister, can you talk a little bit more about those positive exposure events? Is that 36% concerning, and are you still looking at stricter essential worker rules?
Sure, I can do that.
So just on the former question about staff coming in from other district health boards, that's one of the things, of course, that the DHBs would be considering is their ability to make sure they can keep delivering service. Just over 100 staff coming from around the country, remembering that we have around 70,000 staff employed in our district health boards around the country, so it's a small, small proportion of our total staffing. And the DHBs who are offering staff up, and I'm grateful to them, will be thinking about what other arrangements locally they can get and they could put in place, for example, using staff from casual pools. The question about the age profile of people in ICU, I'm sorry, I only have the breakdown of people in hospital in total. Mm. I do know that the youngest person in ICU was 18. And what I would say is all are stable, but anyone who is ventilated in ICU might be stable but quite unwell. And so that's an indication that, again, this is not a trivial infection, that some people are very unwell in our ICUs.
Prime Minister.
And just to finish on your question, so I mentioned of those cases that we've had reported today, that 7 were considered to have been infectious in the community, and that in total they had 9 exposure events. So they might have more than one per person, for instance. But just to give you a quick insight, 5 were visits to the supermarket or dairy. The next highest was 2, which to visits to a health service or pharmacy. So it just gives you a sense that they actually on this list for the most part, and 1 was an essential goods or service worker. So for the most part, we've seen things that people are permitted to do at level 4. For yesterday, we had a higher number of people who were essential workers, but then in and around that, it was still things like supermarkets, pharmacies and health clinics.
So is that an acceptable, I know there's no acceptable level of risk, but in terms of those essential services and just the fact that people are going to have to be going to those places, are you satisfied with the rules and standards that are in place in those essential workplaces?
So two things that are really important for us, that we still have the very best infection protection controls we can at those places people are still able to go. And that's one of the reasons why we have a limited number of places that are open. It means that you are able to see fairly rigorous controls in place at places like supermarkets. So that's one thing, try and reduce the risk of places that people just have to be able to go to. The second thing we want to really start seeing is either a greater proportion of people who are already identified as contacts or household contacts and are therefore at home, because then you get no exposure events attached to them if they're following all of our guidelines and rules. So honing in on some of those mystery cases, seeing if greater surveillance testing in certain areas can help us get ahead of some of those, or earlier on identify some of their links to get those numbers down. Those are two particular focuses for us at the moment. So we have been looking at that. Early suggestions seem to be that where we are seeing cases often The most common workplace cases are actually being brought in outside of the workplace, and then there happens to be limited transmission within those workplaces. We've seen good responses from workplaces where that's happened, but the common theme seems to be if you're in very large factory-style situations that might not have good ventilation. Very, very hard in those scenarios. So the best thing that we can do is just get people out of circulation as early as possible. Prime so nothing yet, but our public health team are analysing everything very carefully.
I'll come to Thomas, then Jenna, then...
Is the government currently in talks with private security contractors to help New Zealand evacuees leave Afghanistan? And if so, or if not, would you object to using private security contractors to get people out?
So I've asked our ministers and agencies to bring forward advice to Cabinet on bringing those remaining New Zealanders out of Afghanistan. You'll forgive me for not wanting to talk in too much detail at this stage, but very conventional options are on the table, obviously. Diplomatic means, working alongside international partners, and of course, you know, there's a lot of discussion at the moment around other borders. But I wouldn't want to, at this stage, get into more detail than that. I also don't want to talk too much about where our people are that we might need to be removing them from. But I will, once Cabinet's made decisions, report back to you. I had Jenna, and then I think I had Jenna. Yes.
We've spoken to the family.
And then Henry.
We've spoken to the family of a man who is dying. His brother has been granted a humanitarian border exemption by the Ministry of Health. Goodbye, but he's been declined an emergency MIQ spot because he's not a citizen. Is MB being too rigid and undermining the Ministry of Health here? And does this all point to the fact that there is a lack of spaces and a lack of staff to run the facility?
No, that's been a long-standing issue around access to our MIQ. You use the word citizen, so I assume therefore that the person doesn't have permanent residency either. So, of course, there have always been limitations over who can access our managed isolation facilities, and that's been the case since they opened, unless, of course, you're coming in for the longer term. Those who are coming in for the longer term and are critical workers, like health workers and so on, are able to, but otherwise, those who can come into MIQ is limited to those who have those legal entitlements to be in New Zealand, and that is one of the devastatingly sad things about what we've had to do at our borders.
But if the Ministry of Health has signed off on humanitarian grounds, that
would ultimately suggest to me, of course, that health aren't assessing people's legal eligibility. That's something that obviously comes through our MIQ system.
Do you have any concerns about the... Sorry, Dr. Bloomfield, do you have any concerns about the visit policies in place at any of our hospitals, as some of them are more strict than others?
What sort of policies? Sorry, I just missed
the... Visitor policies.
Visitor policies. Well, there's a very clear set of criteria, instructions nationally, but then the way that is applied locally is up to the individual DHBs, as long as they have absolute rigorous measures in place to reduce any risk. So there may be some flexibility locally, but there's very clear guidance nationally.
Prime Minister, are you totally comfortable with the fact that three people, staff knows of, went to Auckland Airport or able to fly around the country during level four without any kind of exception? And are you totally comfortable that that hole has been plugged and ABSSEC are now checking everyone?
Yeah, so of course we have put in our expectations around really only those people who are deemed to be essential workers and who are required to move around as part of fulfilling the essential work to be accessing regional travel. So regional travel is available, but on very limited circumstances. So without speaking to individual cases, we have had checks taking place. Airports have been reporting into us what they've been seeing. But, of course, we actually want people to do their bit as well. We need everyone to make sure they're following the rules and complying so that we can lift restrictions as soon as we can.
Is the $300 fine enough, or is that not enough of an incentive?
Well, I would have thought that potentially passing on COVID-19 to others would be the biggest disincentive that there is, and doing your bit for your community is the biggest incentive there is. But, of course, we do always keep an assessment on fines relative to each other as well. It's something Minister Hipkins particularly keeps an eye on.
On those cases yesterday, you were saying 36% were infected by the community. That doesn't quite match up the number of people who are not contacts. So are there people who are
contacts on that,
don't know it?
No. So a good question, and we're digging into that a little bit further, but the one assumption that you can't make, of course, they might have not known that they were a contact for all of their infectious period. So they may have been contacted as a contact and then isolated, but have already made a few visits to a supermarket or may have already gone to work before they were advised. So that's the difference, but we are drilling into some of those numbers in order to assess whether that's the case or whether or not we have issues with compliance. But generally, our public health units are generally reporting what they believe to be overall, not perfect, but good levels of compliance.
So we're well past 2 weeks on from the...
You misunderstand me. So you can still, of course, be identified as being a contact while you're in lockdown, but have still gone to the supermarket or gone to the pharmacy.
No, I understand that. As new primary, we're well past 2 weeks of lockdown. Most of these cases now, are they still mostly household cases? Can you have a rough idea of the proportion of the new cases of the last week or so?
Yeah, so we've been giving percentage numbers daily, and you are seeing those household numbers increase, and we are seeing the number of exposure events attached to other cases decreased. But I think what we really need to see is those unlinked cases. They are the ones where you're most likely, therefore, to see exposure events because they haven't been advised they're a contact or they're at risk. So that's where you're starting. We see them going out as essential workers. So while they're tracking in the right direction, they're not zero. So that's what we really want to start trying to get a much better handle on and get in front of with using the intelligence we have to get a bit more surveillance testing out there in certain areas. But your comments on that, Dr. Bloomfield?
So just generally...
Because it's the right questions that we're asking.
Yeah, the last 4 or 5 days, over at least 50% and somewhere between 50 and 60% of people have been household contacts. Mm. The other thing about yesterday's, which was a quite large number of cases, 45% of those were a result of day 12 tests. So they might have been people who had been waiting, were still asymptomatic, had their day 12 test and were found to have been a case, but they had been isolated.
Is there a natural ceiling to the outbreak then of when you run out of those household contacts? Obviously, there's 36,000 or so wider contacts. You'd hope that the outbreak would never get to that level. But surely you've got a kind of idea of how many people are in a household now.
Yeah.
You could say maybe 2,000.
And we know the positivity rate of those households as well.
Yeah, so we're modelling that, and our person who does the modelling has just been off for a couple of days, we're modelling the... What are the total number of cases we might expect from the household contacts, looking at the infection rate that we've seen to date, which has been about 25%, but it'll probably go up a bit. And then we can say, well, we're going to get to a point where that's where this is the number and this is where that's likely to finish. But that's really not where our focus is. Our focus is on those other cases, and that's where we put our investigative sort of capacity is on those cases that are on the face of it at first are not linked.
Just on contacts, how many close contacts are still isolating in the South Island, and how many of the close contacts in the South Island are still waiting for day 12 test results?
So I can't remember the exact number, but they...
I've got them because it's for question time as well. So we have 500... Oh, sorry. We've got 512 who were identified as non-contacts in the South Island. Of that now, the number is down to 15 who are overdue their day 12 test and are being followed up. Seven are not yet due their day 12 test. But I would just caution that those are the contacts that we, of course, know about. So we don't base every alert level decision just on known contacts. We also identify the relative risk of getting it wrong if you don't know all of the contacts.
Every one of those people had a negative test initially.
And how many of those 512 are still in proper isolation?
Yes, so they all have ongoing checks to ensure they are. So there was a misconception yesterday in the House that somehow the contact tracers have done absolutely their job. Those 512, you can see the compliance is really high. We're just chasing some remaining data up tests. Mark, then Ben, and then I might need to get in the House. Mark.
On mandatory record keeping, there's been an open letter signed by a number of academics, including people like Sean Hendy and Susan Wild, saying that the government should legislate to protect that contact tracing data from being used for any other purpose.
Oh.
Is that something that you'd look at? Mr. Hopkins had indicated he might, but then said actually his assurance should be enough.
Yeah. Well, look, we intend to use it for nothing else, so there'd be no reason why we would be worried about having that additional assurance. But would you mind if we just go away and look at the fact that that might already be the case, I would have thought, actually, in the way that we've built it.
Australian leaders are increasingly talking down Delta and their chances of eliminating Delta. More specifically, Scott Morrison's called it absurd. Yesterday, Josh Frydenberg said it can't be done. What do you make of this criticism of New Zealand's approach? And secondly, where currently is your confidence level that you will be able to do it?
Yeah. Well, the first thing I'd say is that Delta is different. No one's denying that. But I think what you'd also certainly see from everyone is a view that actually the focus has to be before you change up your plan is vaccinating people. And that's what we've always said. Elimination is the best strategy for us while we're vaccinating people. And then we'll continue to look at all of the evidence going forward. We've said that for some time. But for now, it is the best strategy for us. So yes, I see different leaders in Australia taking different positions, but I actually think you'd see generally that their view would be keeping those cases down while you vaccinate has to be the goal, and that's certainly ours.
How many positive cases are still
in? 85% of the New Zealand Herald's poll shows...
I'll let you finish, Ben, and then I'm very quickly going to see if I can get in Jane and Ruku White and then finish.
The New Zealand Herald poll today shows that 85% of Kiwis support elimination. How heartened are you by that? Kiwis are supporting...
Really heartened, and you can see that in the compliance. And this is a strategy that has worked because New Zealand supported it. We just need to keep going. Jane and then Ruku White.
How many positive cases are still not in MIQ, do you know? Are the backup, are the new quarantine hotels ready?
Yes.
And should people with Delta be allowed out of their rooms to exercise?
So we already, as I understand, we already have the capacity we need for all of those cases that have been identified today, and we're bringing in additional space as well. And on the backlog, I understand that it's been cleared and that we essentially, as the new cases come in, it's now just a matter of transferring. In terms of...
Experts saying people should be confined to their rooms because of Delta.
Yes, and that has been the practice when you are a COVID positive case.
So I think for Māori in the Kaitaia area planning a vaccination day for their students and their whānau members, their staff. How's the government going to support Kurukatupa Māori to roll out those vaccine schemes within their kura?
Well, if they tell us what they need, I know that we'd be willing to support it because that's exactly the kind of innovation and the kind of initiatives that we need to continue to see the rollout grow in all our communities. Cheers.